gaan.
All right, let's see. It's very good to be in Amsterdam. Quick question for you. Who here would describe themselves as a geek? Who here is a geek? Raise your hand. Okay, all right, good. All right, so today we're going to talk about, well, it's a geek's guide to becoming an entrepreneur. It's from personal experience. I'm a self-admitted geek. I'm part of a 12-step program. First, though, before you can get into how to become an entrepreneur, you have to, well, you have to establish your geek credentials. So for me, and there's many ways to becoming a geek, but for me, I started coding very young. Okay, that's not really me. My mom would be upset. She's like, that's not my son. I actually started when I was 11 years old and just have been a coder since I was a kid. I was into math, so I was part of the Math Olympics in junior high, the academic decathlon. If you are not a geek here, you knew kids that were like me, I promise. At a sixth grade how-to project, a science how-to project, I converted alternating current to direct current by creating a transformer. And when you go to school with a transformer as your how-to project, I mean, of course, the teacher loves you, but your fellow students, not so much. but the final part of establishing geek, how I'm going to establish my geek credentials is, well, I went to UCLA, computer engineering. I dropped out, but the last thing I coded while I was at UCLA was a two-layer neural network, which back in the day was awesome. I don't know how awesome it is these days. Okay, so though it says number two, it's kind of the first thing in the path to becoming an entrepreneur after you've established your geek credentials is find something broken. Well, this right here is actually a romantic shot of me and my co-founder in front of the Eiffel Tower when we basically had a little bit of a problem. It was in December in Paris, before Uber existed, and we couldn't get a cab. Now, I know none of you have ever experienced this, but before Uber, if you wanted to get a ride in, well, if you were out late at night in Paris, you did not get home unless you walked home. You knew you would be walking home. It didn't matter who you were. And so my co-founder said, you know, I just want to push a button and get a ride. And, well, it was the reason we couldn't get a ride, though, is not just about Paris. It's about cities around the world. And it's about something called a taxi medallion or a taxi license. This right here is a New York City taxi medallion. There are 13,250 of them. Anybody want to guess how many there were in 1949? Somewhere around 13,250. So as a city has changed, the population has substantially changed, the city's substantially changed, the number of taxis has not. It's because, well, those licenses were given away for free, and the folks who got them then started lobbying city council in New York to not add any more, and it got an artificial scarcity. That artificial scarcity meant that by 2014, that single license to own and operate a single taxi was worth over $1 million US. That's why folks fight so hard to keep these things limited. And how the heck is it worth that much? Well, let's see, if you want to be a driver in most cities around the world, you can't just go and drive. You can't just go into business for yourself. You can't, in the European context, do what's called self-establish. You have to ask for permission from the taxi company, and they say, sure, you can be a driver. That will cost you $140 a day. Now, for a driver, that means they are renting a car for $40,000 a year. And you go, wow, this must be some taxi. But it doesn't work out that way. The taxi owners, they get all the money, and, well, you have to really hustle if you're a driver. Okay, that's a Vegas one. But meanwhile, limited number of taxis, what does that mean? That means people wait in line, right? They're not getting around the city as they need to, so I think we've established our problem. Now, it's fine to see the problem as an entrepreneur, but you also have to ultimately have a solution. And for Uber, we say that's transportation as reliable as running water, everywhere, for everyone. That's our mission. That's a solution. If you can make it real, we got a long ways to go. It means taking, well, it means one car serves 30 people instead of 30 cars serving 30 people. It means taking traffic like this, pollution like that, and turning it into something that looks more like this. This is from Delhi, and I don't think this, the road must have been closed to get that picture. Okay. All right. But we take it even further to really make this solution amazing, right? Of course, it's if you get a lot of people using this kind of system, it means that two people will be taking the same trip at the same time. So why not figure out a way to get them in the same car? Imagine pushing a button, car comes, you open the door just like before, but then somebody else is already in it. We call that Uber pool, but what it means is the price goes down by half because you're sharing a ride. But it also means that you're taking, instead of two cars on the road, you're now turning it into one. Again, all these great things that happen for the city. And for, whoops, it went forward. So in Los Angeles, we've done Uber pool in a bunch of cities around the world. In Los Angeles, we've saved 7.9 million miles on the freeways. I'm from Los Angeles originally, it's my hometown. 1.4 thousand metric tons in the first 8 months that we rolled it out. It's far bigger now. Around the world, we have 18 cities with over 100,000 unique people in each of those cities carpooling now on Uber pool every week. And many of these cities, I think we're somewhere around 11, it's over 200,000 people now carpooling that weren't carpooling before. So look, you go, okay, that's great. We turn a problem into a solution, but how hard is your problem? Right? If your problem isn't hard, everybody's going to do it. And some people say, well, Travis, this Uber thing, it's just an app. Like, anybody can make it. They don't always understand what's underneath. But what we have to do is we have to predict demand ahead of time. We have to know that before you open the app, we have to know that there's a certain amount of demand in a particular area. We have to have a sense of, well, events that are happening, venues in the city, overall traffic patterns. We have to know that ahead of time. We have to not just know next week what demand is going to look like, we have to know in the next 15 minutes. Now, you might know where demand is, but that's not enough. You also have to know where supply is. So if you have a heat map of demand, and then you know where the cars are, those cars can be anti-heat. What's left over is residual heat or underserved demand. We then present that to a driver as a heat map, a supply heat map of where they're most likely to get a ride in the next 15 minutes. And what that means is the drivers go to where the underserved demand is. And then we hook that up with price. The places that are most underserved, the price goes up to get more cars there. And the places that are most overserved, the price goes down. Not easy, but it actually gets a bit harder. If you watch the press, you see all the stuff going on with driverless cars. Something that we're investing in as well. There's a lot of real hardcore, really hard problems to solve there and very hardcore technology. The car essentially has to have a three-dimensional view of the world around it. And not only has to have a view of what is there, it has to know what those things are. Is that a trash bag or is it a stroller? Is it a car that's moving or a car that's parked? Is that the curb or is it something else? And perceiving that is actually very hard. You have to start seeing the world like a human sees the world. And these are very difficult problems to solve. Number four in the guide to becoming, the geek's guide to becoming an entrepreneur is be analytical and creative. You can't, a lot of folks think, oh, you're an engineer, you're analytical, you can solve all the world's problems, but it doesn't quite work like that. There's a lot of creativity that goes into finding how to solve a problem in a way that moves people, in a way that inspires. And so you have to really merge the left brain, that analytical side, with the right brain, with the creative side, the emotional side, the heart, and put those two together. This is the Babbage machine, actually the first computing machine that existed, or actually that was designed. super analytical, but what the hell are you going to do with it, right? You have to bring some creativity to it, and Albert Einstein, and I've got a couple Albert Einstein quotes today, says, creativity is intelligence having fun. So at Uber, whether it's myself as the entrepreneur or really anybody we hire, we really look for that analytical creative cross. And so once a year, we, you know, one of the really fun things that we do is it's called Uber Ice Cream. And over in hundreds of cities around the world, for one day, you don't push a button and get a car, you push a button and an ice cream truck comes to you. Now, it's amazing, you get a little chuckle, you're like, oh, that sounds like fun. People lose their minds. Now, the analytical part is, imagine setting up a logistics network of ice cream trucks in hundreds of cities around the world. That's really hard, I promise you, and doing it for only one day, at a profit is very, very difficult, I promise. That's the analytical side. The creative side is, when you push a button and an ice cream truck comes to you, you sort of go back to being an 8-year-old. And well, when you're 8-year-old, you chase the ice cream truck, but now you're more civilized, you're an adult, you're an Uber user, and the ice cream truck comes to you. People lose it, it's amazing. All right, perception versus reality, you have to know the difference. And a really, really important aspect of being an entrepreneur is when conventional wisdom thinks the answer's over there, but reality is over here, the larger the distance between the two, that distance between the two is what I call the innovator's playground. Now you better be right, because sometimes conventional wisdom is correct. But if you are right and there's a huge distance between the two, that is where innovators and entrepreneurs find all of the value and opportunity. And so sometimes it's really confusing to know what is reality and what is perception. This is the last Albert Einstein quote, I promise. The one who follows the crowd will usually go no further than the crowd. The one who walks alone is likely to find themselves in places no one has ever been. The successful entrepreneurs go to those places that no one's ever been. We just naturally get excited about it. We look for when conventional wisdom is wrong. And sometimes when we're kids, we're thought of as annoying. Our parents get upset because we're always debating. It's because we're always looking for that edge where somebody's wrong. And so you have that iconoclastic thing, that sort of rebellious spirit in many entrepreneurs because of this. And often you feel like this. Sometimes it's the other way around, where you're the sad face and everybody else is happy. But you just have to be willing to do that. You have to be willing to cut against the grain. And it's hardest, of course, when everybody says, no, you can't do it, and you're seeing things differently, and you're seeing things in a positive, optimistic way. That can be the hardest. My last company, the first 4 years, didn't pay myself a salary. I like to say, I got no 100 times a day for 4 years straight. Now, it wasn't quite like that, but that's literally hundreds of thousands of no's. And I'm that guy smiling there, and everybody thinks I'm crazy. And so again, if you're gonna play this perception versus reality game, you better be right. If you think it's a kitten, but it's actually a lion, you're in big trouble. But it's, you know, there is this sort of understanding of risk, or sort of accurate assessment of risk. Often the non-entrepreneurs in the room misunderstand risk. I can't tell you how many times when I'm hiring somebody and they're like, oh my God, I don't know if I can go to Uber. Like, you know, I've got a great career and I'm doing this thing. This thing seems so risky. I'm like, you are so smart. You're so intelligent. You can get a job anywhere you go, anywhere you want. There's no risk. Like, I'm paying you a salary. It's going to be okay. People they misunderstand risk. Now, sometimes there's just things that perception and reality is that's just risky. Walking that tightrope is risky. I don't care how you cut it. Unless you build out an expertise where you're particularly good at mitigating risk that nobody else can. And so then, for him, he's just taking a walk in the park. The rest of us are like, it's all you. And again, that becomes the innovator's playground because there's nobody else walking that line. Number six, make magic. So I'm a little old school in my movie tastes. There's a movie called Pulp Fiction, where Samuel L. Jackson, there's this glowing thing in this briefcase, and you never quite see it, but everybody, when they're around it, they're close to it, their eyes get big, and they're just excited. They just feel it. They feel that aura of it. How do you recreate that in the things we make, the things entrepreneurs make? How do they recreate that? Well, at Uber, we like to say there are four dimensions of magic. One is time. If you can give people their time back, you are providing some kind of magic to your customers. If you can bring calm into their day, you are very valuable to the folks who are using your products. Or sometimes it's just bringing a little bit of joy. And for others, it's money. So time, calm, joy, and money are at Uber the four dimensions of magic. Money can be saving people money so they get much more than what they expected, or it can be new ways to make an income that change your life and change how you feed provide for your family. And so magic often, you kind of know it when you see it. I mean, this is amazing. This is the patent on the iPhone in 2006. And I'm like looking at my iPhone, I'm like, I think it's kind of the same. This is, sometimes it requires seeing the future. But you ultimately know it when you see it. These are two bridges in San Francisco. They both go into the city. One is the Bay Bridge, one is, of course, the Golden Gate Bridge. And no matter how many times you go on the Golden Gate Bridge, you're gonna take a picture. You just can't help it. And so when you see magic, you know it. It inspires. It can be aesthetic on the outside, but sometimes you can't see it. Number seven, selling and storytelling. So I like to say at my company, fear is the disease, hustle is the antidote. Right? Go to market. Don't get paralyzed by fear. Figure out what your problem is, and now start taking actions. Do something about it. But going to market and hustling matters. It's the difference between having a great idea and having a great idea that other people know about. And storytelling is the highest form of that. Now, when I was an engineer, I used to think that selling was like this super terrible thing. Like, I used to judge it like all engineers do. And I haven't always been the greatest storyteller myself. I had to sort of get up to speed a little bit because I thought, oh, if you're just telling a story, you look something like this guy. But we have fun when we storytell. We like to say that transportation is kind of a boring, old business. Can we find ways to bring it to life? Can we give our customers who love us a reason to tell their friends? One of the first on-demand marketing stunts that we did was on-demand mariachi bands on the 5th of May, Cinco de Mayo. So you push a button, and these guys show up, and everybody in your office is like, what is happening? In our India team, they had this idea that they would do on-demand choppers. This was definitely a one-time event. But you can go to the next level in storytelling. You can go to a place where you're really speaking from the heart. You capture the essence of what it is you bring, and you inspire everybody who sees it. And so I'll play a little video here.
பயணம் எவ்வளவு சுவாரஸ்யமான ஒரு விஷயம் இல்ல? நம்முடைய தேவைக்கான பயணங்கள் நமக்கு திருப்பி தரதா என்ன? மறக்க முடியாத அனுபவங்கள். பயணம் நம்மளை வேற ஒரு மனிதனாகவே மாத்திடுது. நாளைய பயணம் எப்படி இருக்க போகுது? நல்ல பயணமாக அமையணுங்கிற ஆசையும் பதட்டமும் எல்லாருக்கும் நிறையவே இருக்கு. அதை முடிவு செய்ய போகிறது பயணத்தில் நாம் சந்திக்கிற மனுஷங்க தான். அவங்களுக்கும் நமக்குமான அந்த உறவு தான்.
சார், நான் முகமது இஸ்மாயில், ஊபர் பார்ட்னர் சார். வந்துட்டேன் சார், நான் வெயிட் பண்ணுறேன்.
Okay. I think we're at the last one here. And it's one of the this is the last tip for in the Geek's Guide to Becoming an Entrepreneur. I call it the champion's mindset, and it's actually a cultural value at Uber. A lot of times when people think of champions or they think of winning, they think of, well, in the U.S. it'd be like their favorite basketball star. Out here it might be your favorite football player scoring a goal. Doing something macho and aggressive, that's a lot of times what people think about. But at Uber we think about it differently. We're trying, and often we find ourselves fighting for cities for, we like to say we celebrate the cities, but you often are faced with adversity. And so there's two parts of the champion's mindset. One is putting everything you got out there, every ounce of passion, every ounce of energy you have, putting it on the field and not leaving anything to spare. And part two is when you face adversity, when you get knocked down, you get back up. And if you do those two things, it's actually really, really hard to lose. It's how the true champions become champions. They keep getting back up in the face of adversity. And along the way, of course, you just have to enjoy the ride. It can't be something where, if you don't enjoy it, it doesn't matter how much of a champion you are, you're just not going to be able to take that adversity. You're not going to get back up. You're not going to put all your passion and energy into it. And so we like to show this last video for the last tip for the Geek's Guide to Becoming an Entrepreneur.
The 600 meter underway. Heather Dorner to Minnesota finished second this event a year ago. She was in lane four.
And Dornan is probably going to be your favorite. She actually won the NCAA championships in 2006 in the 800, but she only won one Big Ten championships in the 2 years.
Three laps in this event, 600 meters, three times around the 200 meter track here at the field house.
What a bold move by Fallon. She's looking very confident, and the Penn State runner is just running amazing today. She did win her heat in the 400, but ended up taking fourth overall.
That's Fallon Dorr moving into the lead, a sophomore from Penn State. Dornan running second.
Dornan last year scored 23 points for the Golden Gophers in their Big Ten championship, so they're really relying on getting a lot of points from her this weekend, and she's just coming by Fallon Dorr now in the home stretch, heading into the bell lap.
Dornan falling down, gets up quickly, but that's going to cost her. Lucky she wasn't injured.
Her teammate just went to the front, though, so they may be able to recover from that. And Dornan is flying down the backstretch.
She is catching up.
She is going to catch Fallon Dorr, and she may catch the leaders.
Wow.
Wow. She's got Fallon.
This is a gutsy effort by Dornan. Can't she pull it off? She's moving to third. Dornan coming down the stretch from the outside. Dornan coming on strong. Dornan all the way. Dornan. Yes. Yes. She did it.
That's being a champion. So guys, that's the best I got. That's the Geek's Guide to Becoming an Entrepreneur. I don't know if I got anything more useful to say. I wanted to thank you guys for listening. But before I go, I want to make a little bit of announcement. Something that we're really excited to announce here at Startup Fest is we have something called Uber Pitch, which is over the next month, we are going to have a sort of famous seed capital, seed investors, VCs, members of sort of the startup ecosystem in cars across in 30 cities across the continent of Europe, and people are going to at different times, different places, and we'll be announcing them as they roll. You push a button, and you can pitch a VC. Now, as an entrepreneur, I've seen a lot more failure than I've seen success. I know that you probably don't believe me, but trust me, I meant many years running out of money, being poor, going back to families, friends, wherever I could, because I didn't have enough money to have my own place. I could go on. But, I never could push a button and pitch somebody, so I had to accidentally run into them at the hotel, or maybe just walk into the VC firm without an appointment. Might have happened. Not saying it definitely did. But anyways, guys, we're really excited to announce this, and thank you for listening, and it's really good to be here, and thank you.